Over the last 500 years, the printed book has been a boon to both social and scientific progress. But imagine that you're a student, tasked with learning a new concept in communication, and you come to your local library, maybe like this one. A student might go to the shelves, pull a book, look through it, maybe jump directly to the glossary, reshelve the book, and then move down the line, pulling out the next one, reading through it, probably jumping directly to the glossary, putting it right back. Now, this can be a very time-consuming and complicated way of learning about concepts in communication research. Now, we have the card catalog, and that in theory will help you to find what you're looking for, but the problem with a card catalog is you have to already know what it is you're looking for. It doesn't really provide tools for exploring concepts you haven't already been exposed to. Computer systems have come along, and they've been developed to help kind of augment the card catalog and help students to be exposed to concepts they don't already know about, but they're still not very good at this yet. And so while a library is a good repository of concepts in communication research, it's not a very good way for finding concepts in communication research. So what we need is a tool or a process for finding these concepts and dealing with all of the concepts on the library shelf. Imagine you have a company that makes food, and you want to sell that food all over the country. This is a very complicated process, and you'll need to engage in something called logistics. So let's take, for example, your factory. Your factory produces food, but you're going to need raw resources in order to do this. You're probably going to get some sort of grain or something else related to this from farms. These farms produce the raw resources that you need and ship them to your factory. Your factory produces the food that you want to sell, but it's complicated getting your food shipped all over the country. You might use a truck in order to ship things over the highway. You might use trains to ship things at higher speeds over rail, or you might use airplanes to ship things across the entire country. Depending on which modes of transportation you're going to use, your factory probably has to repackage the food in different ways. Once the food is placed onto trucks or trains or planes, they're shipped off to their destinations, which are the thousands of stores all over the country. Depending on where these stores are, the trucks and the trains and the airplanes will probably all travel along different routes and along different schedules in order to bring your food to stores. The complicated process of scheduling and planning this entire chain, from the original farms that create the raw materials to your factory which produces the food and repackages them depending upon the mode of transportation, and eventually sends them off to the thousands of stores to be sold across the country, is a process called logistics. We can use this same process in an academic sense, not just in a commercial one. For instance, instead of farms producing raw materials, we might have researchers producing new or novel concepts. And instead of these concepts being shipped off to a factory to be put together, in an academic sense, factories are colleges, universities, and research centers, where people collaborate together to produce high-quality concepts that are ready for distribution across the academic field. Depending on how the concepts are used and what their intended target is, instead of being put on trucks and trains and airplanes, concepts in communication research can be sent via books, or journals, or conferences. And instead of this information being sent to stores where it can be sold, it's sent to an important audience, students in communication research. So just as we can use logistics to move products and services across the country, so too can we use conceptual logistics in order to move novel or new communication concepts from their original researchers, through research centers, through publication in books or journals, through sharing at conferences, and eventually to students who can use these concepts in their own work. This process is a complicated one, but conceptual logistics does provide tools for allowing students to access concepts in communication research that might otherwise be too difficult to find. So now that we've looked at some of the problems a student might face wandering into the library full of fantastic but contradictory concepts in communication research, and now that we've looked at what logistics means, the ability to bring all of our resources together in meaningful ways, let's put the two together. We're working on a project called Conceptual Logistics. Conceptual logistics is the ability for a student or a researcher not to just memorize one definition, but instead to find all of those wonderfully competing definitions and synthesize new ones. All too often, faculty walk into the university classroom and assign the textbook. But unfortunately, while these take time, effort, and money to produce, very little effort is put into actually using them. Students will leaf through the book, read the assigned chapter for the week, and then at the end, there's usually a glossary where they can memorize the definition of the terms just long enough to pass the test. But research shows us that this simply is not producing a good enough student. It's not producing a good enough employee, and it's not producing a good enough researcher. Instead, what we need are students that can take one idea, one concept, and can then take a second idea or a second concept, and instead of having to memorize both or select just one of them, can instead bring the two together and reconceptualize them into new, creative, innovative, interesting ideas. A student that has this skill is going to go very far. And so the Society for Conceptual Logistics in Communication Research are looking for ways to promote conceptual logistics. We're working on online activities, such as our own concept toolkit and visualizations, that allow students to collaborate online, taking old ideas, understanding new ideas, and synthesizing even better ones. We're also working on in-classroom activities, such as conceptual blending and visualizing conceptualizing. These are activities that allow them to engage outside the field of communication, outside of their own headspace, with other students and other faculty in meaningful ways to better understand human communication research. It isn't enough for students to know some information, and it's impossible for students to know all the information. Instead, what we need are students that can acquire some information and help to create and understand new information. And if we can do this, we'll successfully create a new generation of communication scholars.